Boy, do I have a treat for you guys. These are my three, actually there's four, one's just not really worth mentioning, towers I just acquired the other day for free, all of which are mid to late 90s based, I'd guess, just by looking at them. We have an IBM Aptiva multimedia PC, generic white box, and another generic white box. This one, I've already tested these two, this one and this one, to see if they power up without exploding, and they do. This one will post, this one will not. This one has a 333 megahertz Celeron, and I upgraded the RAM to supposedly 768 megabytes, but it's only going to recognize 524 megabytes. I'm guessing chipset limitations there. This one, I've tried everything. Everything. And it will not post. These sat in a, I guess you could say, kind of a garage shed thing. Up in rafters for about 6 years, so it's been exposed to hot, cold, moisture, whatever else. They look nice, like the insides are nice, but that one won't post. So we're going to try to figure that out, but I make no promises. But let's go ahead, crack open this one, and I'll show you the guts. This one, actually. These two, back in the day, must have been Goodwill or Salvation Army finds, because this one's labeled, or garage sale, because it's labeled with a $4 price tag, and this one up here has what looks to be a Goodwill sticker to me, because they always label them like this for pricing. It's labeled as $20, and it also has a sticky note that says it's an Intel Celeron with 320 megs of RAM, and two 6.6 gigabyte hard drives with Windows XP. Now, I don't think they're 6.6 gigs each. The hard drives that are in this is very, very old Western Digital drives, like probably around 2 to 3 gigs max, and they sound terrible. But I don't know if they're bad, because drives from that era always sounded terrible. But let's go ahead and crack it open, and I'll show you guys around. I'll be right back. And we're back. And down inside here, you can see the all the memory modules, got the three slots maxed out, the 333 megahertz Celeron. There's a PowerMan FSP 235 watt power supply in here. That looks to be original. We have down here a GeForce MX440 by NVIDIA that I added in, the broken Wi-Fi card that was in it when I got it, and what else was on the back? Oh, the sound card of unknown type. I don't remember if I showed the back of this, probably not, but on the back we have the power supply, the PS2 keyboard and mouse ports, two USB 1.1 ports, two serial ports, a parallel port, and that's it. No onboard audio, nothing like that. And then we got everything else that was in it, or I added. But, so yeah, inside of the machine actually looks quite clean. You can kind of see the two old Western Digital drives in there. No real dust to speak of. So, that's the first machine. The one thing I will tell you is the CPU fan, and by the way, I did pull that out and clean it. The bearing is going out badly, so it sounds like a grind fest, or it doesn't sound very healthy. So, I don't know what I'm going to do with that. I don't have another 40 millimeter fan to put on there. I used to, don't know what happened to it. But anyway, let's move on to the second system. So, be back. Alright, for this white box beauty, it's pretty much the same story as that one. On the back here, we have a replacement Antec power supply. It looked to be about a 310 watt when I looked at the sticker. Looks like the original power supply might have blown up and somebody replaced it with this, which could be the reason why it won't post now. It could have taken out the motherboard when it did so. But on the back, we have labeled PS2 keyboard and mouse ports, two USB 1.1 ports, two serial, parallel, a gamepad port, I don't remember the exact code name for it, onboard audio, and a VGA video card of some type. There was a dial-up modem, 56K modem, and something else in here that I removed because I was troubleshooting this thing trying to get the fucker to post. It also has a slot you could add like a 48 to an 80 millimeter van, something like that, but that'd be kind of pointless. Inside, well, this case design is also freaking awesome. You remove these two thumb screws on the back here. The top, God damn it, don't be a bitch. Seriously? The top pops off. Okay. Then the side panels just lift up. Now this system is interesting because it's got two types of RAM slots. We have RD RAM slots and we have SD RAM slots. The RD RAM slots hold the blanking plates right now, which is, I'm very thankful for that, because if you remove the blanking plates from an RD RAM system, it won't post at all. So you'll be out of luck with that. I didn't screw down the video card. But inside, we have 256 megs of SD RAM, a 733 megahertz Intel Pentium 3 with a beautifully quiet fan. Bearings are not dead in that one. And the power supply fans seem to work. Oh, I just noticed. Won't focus on it, but it lists the wattage of this power supply right here. It's a 330 watt, which is totally overkill for this system. It's even got custom sleeve 24 pin, so, and SATA power up here, so it's got to be a relatively new power supply. It's all still bundled up there. No hard drive. We do have a front case fan, and I removed all the expansion cards that came in it to troubleshoot. It's got a replacement CMOS battery now. This CMOS battery is from 2006, so it may or may not be good. But that's really all there is to see on this system. I need to screw down the video card. Didn't realize I hadn't done that yet. So I'm going to get that screwed down, and then we'll take a look at the Aptiva, because this thing is interesting. This thing, we're getting old. But talk to you in a minute, guys. Yep. This system is interesting. And it's very heavy. But this is the oldest system that I have, the IBM Aptiva Multimedia System. And it's got a little hideaway door that's hiding a compact disk drive and a 3.5-inch floppy drive. So let's go ahead and get inside this. This I'm going to have to turn the camera off for, because I have to remove two screws and pull the system out of the shell, because that's the way they like to do things. So I'll be right back. Okay, so the system is mostly out of the shell. I'm not going to take it all the way out because to get the thing back on the rails of the shell, it's kind of a pain in the butt. But this system gets interesting. One, because of its configuration, and two, it's still got two hard drives in it. One of them is still hooked up, although it's barely secured. This one looks like it's going to be a Western Digital 2.1 gig hard drive. It's only held in by one screw, so I'm sure that's great. And then the one up here is a Western Digital Caviar, probably 3 gig drive. Now, I was told by the owner of these systems that this one was for parts, that he couldn't remember if this one was for parts or if it was a working system. But I see a massive, absolutely massive sound card in the back here. Oh, this is a combination sound card, modem, and I'm guessing gamepad? I'm not real sure. It's got a 12-volt out to power speakers. That is very strange. I've never seen that before. It does have rear I.O., and quite a lot of it, for its age. We have PS2 keyboard and mouse, serial port, one USB port, printer port, and VGA out, so it's got onboard video. This here looks like one big riser card on the system board. I don't know how well I'll be able to get down there and you'll be able to see it. But as you can see, it does have memory. It looks like the 72-pin DIMMs. I'm guessing 16 megs of RAM, but I'm not entirely sure. In order to see the CPU, which is quite the feat, honestly, with that board in the way. Come on. In order to get to the CPU, if I can even find the fucker, it is somewhere underneath that board, that riser board. But, judging by the looks of it, I would say Pentium 75 Plus. It could be a Pentium Pro. I'm not entirely sure, but by the age of the system, I'd say Pentium Pro and up from there. But, wish I could show it to you guys. I just can't get the camera in there, because it's right underneath the board here. I don't even know what I'm looking at now. Probably not what I need to be. But it's somewhere up there. I do believe. Oh, wait, no. Nope. It's right here. Right here. I see it now. It is right there underneath the hard drives. One of the hard drives. So I'd say Pentium 75. Is that a cache module right there? I can't really tell from the viewfinder. What is that? Interesting. But, so that's this system. This one is not confirmed working, and honestly, I'm kind of afraid to plug it in because it's a very old AT power supply, and it's been sitting in a shed for 6 years. What's the worst that could blow up when I plug it in? Alright, guys, I'm gonna put this one back together, and then we'll start bringing out monitor, keyboard, and mouse. I did have a gigantic CRT. I'm not lugging that out here. It is way too big. It takes up way too much space. And the image quality really isn't that great. I kind of wish I didn't keep it. Maybe it just needs calibration, but the text is quite fuzzy. Like, it works, and the color, there's no burn-in, but the text isn't clear, and it gives me a headache trying to use it. So, alright guys, talk to you in a minute. Alrighty guys, well, I decided to plug in the IBM Aptiva first. Got everything plugged in. It's got power, video, keyboard, mouse. So, let's hit the power button, see what happens. Hard drive spun up. But we don't seem to have post. Hard drive and power light are on solid. Huh? Wait a minute. Something's happening, but we don't seem to be getting video output. Let me check the monitor. Ah! Holy shit! It's working. Okay, we have a keyboard error. Let's go to setup utility. It's got Windows, it's still got Windows 95 Plus on it. Wow. Listen to that hard drive. It fucking works. You guys have no idea how excited I am. Oh my god. I got really depressed for a second and then might have to pause the video if anything personal on the screen comes up. Because I don't know who these PCs belong to. Wow. MS-DOS prompt. I see IBM antivirus for Windows. IBM. This might be a factory install of Windows. It's got the original IBM utilities on it. Wow, this is a factory install. Aptiva Entertainment. Video CD player. This is a factory install of... Wow. This thing has been, like, untouched by time. I kind of wonder... This is booting off the... What looks to be a 2-gig hard drive. It was the only one plugged in. I wonder what's on the 3-gig. Is this not even hooked up? My computer... Properties. Okay. Oh, wow. So, it's an IBM Aptiva with a Pentium CPU and 48 megs of RAM. That is way more than I thought it would have. 48 megs of RAM for Windows 95, and this is the original Windows install, which means I think this thing came teched out with 48 megs of RAM. Wow. That's freaking awesome. What do we have for display? It's got an ATI Rage 2 for onboard graphics. This thing, I wonder if they have any utilities to check the health of the hard drives on something this old, because I'm leaving this untouched. This is going to be, and see if the optical drive works. I still haven't mounted the hard drive properly. Optical drive even goes in and out. This thing is cool. Open the recycling bin. What's in here? See, games. Looks like crap ton of games files. And these are all dated 2010. So that goes to show you, this was indeed sitting in a shed for 6 years. It hasn't been touched since 2010. Oh, wow, even the... No, it's not. Never mind. It says it's 9:44 a.m. What does it think the date is? Well, it's got the year and month right. It just thinks it's 9:44 when it's in fact 12:49. So the battery is starting to get a bit weak. I'm guessing it's not a standard CMOS clock battery, which kind of sucks. I just see a ton of game files in the recycling bin. Looks like there's a game installed that they just deleted. What's this thing got for documents, programs, Sierra, Real Player, it's got Real Player, QuickBooks, it's got QuickBooks, M-Wave, Modem and Audio, Microsoft Works 4.0, Microsoft Hardware, Information Superhighway, it's got America Online, and Netscape Navigator. I don't have a phone line, but this would be hilarious to try to dial into. Wow. Okay, there's going to be some videos on this thing later, for sure. I don't think there's really disabled startup items, TV entertainment. I don't see anything for games. There is video and poker. So this is a very Claire de Lune. I don't have any speakers I could hook up either. I don't know if it's got onboard sound. I doubt it. Doesn't look like it's got onboard sound. Alright, so that's one down. Two to go. Let's see if we can get them functioning. Go ahead and shut it down. Shut down computer. I cannot believe it works. That is awesome. It works and it's original install. Cool, cool. Alright, be back when I have the second one hooked up. Alright, we got the second beast hooked up. Let's go ahead and smash that power button. That sounds terrible. That is the CPU fan. It is still spinning, but that's literally what it sounds like. Oh well. So it's doing a RAM check. See if we can skip that. Oh, how interesting. I'll be right back. Let me see if I can do something about that noise. Okay, so I couldn't do anything about the noise. That fan bearing is just toast. But, after two keyboards, it took me... I couldn't get F1, F2 to enter BIOS when it would ask me to on this system. So I had to switch keyboards. I got the time and date set up so now I won't have any errors. But let's go ahead and boot this thing up. So, here it goes. Supposedly it's running Windows XP, and I have 512 megs of RAM recognized in the system instead of 320, because 320 megs of RAM and XP, no thank you. So, Intel Celeron 333 megahertz, go ahead and skip mem check, which, really, it's not going to let me do now? Why? Seriously? Oh, Jesus Christ. I remember now, I don't have fastboot enabled, which enables RAM check skip. Okay, I'm going to pause the video until this is done, because I'm going to be sitting here for the next 5 minutes. Ugh. Alright, we're almost done. 470 megs. And that fan is sounding really bad.
I have to enable that fast boot because that's...
Alright, we have two hard drives detected. Cool. Please boot. It's trying to boot off floppy first. Oh, those hard drives are so dead. No way. I mean, I know old hard drives used to sound bad, but that sounds dead. That sounds like the click of death. Like, it's actually... That sounds like seek errors. Will there be a password? File system? I bet the file system is screwed. And all of a sudden, I don't have a keyboard. Why? I enabled legacy USB device support, and it seems to have disabled the PS2 keyboard, which is hilarious. Well, this is going. I'm going to go get a USB keyboard. Be right back. Okay, I got a USB keyboard now. Everything's configured. Also, look what I found. Replacement fan with good bearings. Yay. So that'll be replacing the fan on the 300 MHz CPU right now because it's still terrible. But let's go ahead and fire it up again. This time boot into Windows. Skip RAM check. I didn't want to go into the BIOS. Oops. Well, guess we're checking out the BIOS. I just wanted to skip the RAM check. Megs of RAM. Guess I haven't showed the BIOS on this thing yet. It's actually a relatively decent BIOS. We got standard CMOS, 27th of 2016, everything's set to auto so I don't have to configure anything. Advanced CMOS setup so I can configure quick boot, which I need to enable that. System BIOS cacheable, primary display, there's a ton of features. Not sure what this is. I'm not sure what that is, if you can, like, emulate different CPUs. I know on this thing, it actually does give you the option to change the CPU speed based on your needs. So you could have it at 333 MHz, 300, 266, 233, or 133. So right now it's set to 333. I'm going to save and exit. Now we're booting to Windows. Hard to believe we still have one more tower left, but I really don't think that tower is going to post. Got the GeForce 4MX 440 in there. I was going to make this thing a vintage gaming system, but I want to use that tower, as it's got a 733 MHz Pentium and not a 333 MHz Celeron. I tried to swap the 733 Pentium into this system and it recognized it as an unrecognizable Intel Pentium or an Intel processor, so it needs a BIOS update and I don't have a floppy disk. So, yeah. Can't do anything about that right now. The system does have two 6-gig hard drives. The second one wasn't formatted. It is, in fact, running Windows XP Home Edition. It looks like Goodwill or some sort of tech place just threw a real fast, quick install on here. It doesn't really have anything on it in terms of, like, user preference software. It's got, like, Malwarebytes and a couple other things, but this looks like an entirely fresh install. It's not even, like, Service Pack 2. It's Service Pack 1A. And it doesn't have the MX440's display drivers, because I haven't connected to the internet. Something. No. Something about the license validation of Windows XP. I wonder if they cracked this. If it's still... it's not going to let me log... Son of a bitch! It's not going to let me log on because Windows isn't activated. Those sneaky cunts. I hate it when people don't do shit legitimately. Please let me log on. Yeah. Problem has prevented Windows from accurately checking the status of the license for this computer. Okay. But let me log on if click yes and try to activate it. This thing is really slow on Windows XP. Whoever was brave enough to put XP on this thing with a 300 megahertz CPU. 300 megahertz is the absolute minimum system requirement for Windows XP. And when they say minimum, they mean it. But I'm going to attempt to activate Windows over the phone. So I'll be right back. Okay, so got Windows activated. All I needed was the key input again, apparently. I didn't like, you know, the date change and some of the hardware I fiddled with, I guess. I just didn't like it. So let's go ahead and boot this one last time. And let everything load in the taskbar. Which this camera isn't going to focus on. But, yeah, it looks like we got some funky icons, like a theme going on, got Malwarebytes, CC Cleaner. I don't see anything else on the desktop. It just looks like a very basic install. Anything in my documents? There's nothing. No music, no pictures. It's got Windows Movie Maker. Honestly, it runs pretty quick for being a 300 megahertz CPU. Task Manager, although it's not running any of the latest service packs. But it's, we got 375 megs of RAM available. Total of 523. But, yeah. So it runs. What has it got for games? Standard XP game, Delphin, Media Viewer, CC Cleaner. Yeah. Fibros Casino. Something something AOL Refer a Friend. PixAround, WinZip, Remote Assistance. So yeah. Really basic. Even the username is just named user. So looks like just a basic install. Control panel. My computer properties. So, here's the specs. Registered to Tim Baker. Microsoft Windows XP Home Edition. No service packs. Intel Celeron processor. 334 megahertz. So, alrighty guys, let's see if we can get the last system working. Go ahead and shut this one down. What I do find funny is the other system, which I thought was older, it is older, the IBM Aptiva, has the system power off logic on the board, whereas this one, you'll notice, when you shut it down, it'll spin down the drives. I remember these on the Windows 98 machines back when I was littler in school. It'd do the whole, it's not safe to turn off your PC. It is now safe to turn off your computer. So after the drive spin down, didn't want to do that. Who's going to power back? Who's going to spin the drives back up without shutting off the system? But, so yeah, that's that system. On to the next. And the dog. Titan. Titan. You're on camera. You're on camera. You don't care. See you in a minute. Well, after about 30 minutes of screwing around with this thing, trying to get it to post, I think I finally got it working. I had to keep swapping a stick of RAM in and out of both of the SD RAM slots. I think there's some crap in there, maybe some corrosion because they hadn't been used in so long. But after I have one 64 meg stick of RAM in there, an SD RAM stick right now, and it just posted, and then I shut it off. So let's go ahead and boot it. This system is much quieter than the other one. So, we have a post. It's a Super Micro board. Tab to show post screen. Okay. CMOS settings wrong. Let's see if I can auto adjust this. We have 65 megs of RAM, of course. F1 to run setup. I want F1 to run setup, please. Did this on the last system.
Really?
Where it just, it wouldn't. Do I have a keyboard? Not on this one. This one? No keyboard. But I have a Coppermine Pentium 3 at 733 megahertz. And I'll be right back. Plugging in the keyboard really helps. Ramcheck, delete, run setup. CMOS settings wrong. F1 to run setup. Kind of bias is this one going to have? Is it going to run setup? Or not? Is it a reset button? What is that? Let's try that again. Something not right there. Love this case though. I love how quiet this Pentium 3 is. Delete to enter BIOS setup. Yes. F2, load default settings and continue. It's gonna complain because there's no hard drives. I think. Let's try this again. All I want is the BIOS, please. That's all I ask for. Yeah, it's got the same BIOS as the other one. All right, so I forgot the arrow keys are a bit wonky on this keyboard. Standard CMOS setup. It thinks it's 1996. It's most definitely not. The keyboard is really bad. Yeah, that or the BIOS is just that laggy with 64 megs of RAM. Because it's like, I have to wait. Come on, almost there. Thank you. I'll just go with 2016 for now. The BIOS is seriously lagging. Which is freaking hilarious. Is this keyboard working the BIOS? No, that one doesn't. Fancy my setup. Quick boot. Enabled. Look, now it's not writing. Display mode, smart for hard disks, enabled. Primary display, password check. So it's got the same BIOS as the other board. Advanced chipset. Graphics aperture size. It's kind of interesting that this can use RAM bus RAM and SD RAM at the same time. PCI plug and play. Peripheral setup. Hardware monitor, it's got CPU temperature detection. Wow! On a slot 1 Pentium? Apparently the CPU is 30 degrees Celsius. We'll have it tell us when it gets to what would be a safe temp for these older chips. Let's say 60°C. That's amazing! This motherboard does actually have multiple fan headers, so I don't know what it is, but I can only press it 3 times, and then I have to wait. It's got thermal fan control. Apparently that keeps frozen. Don't freeze on me. You're not allowed. Thank you. The 12 volt rail's a little low, if that's accurate. It's at 11.42 volts. All of the, and the 5 volt is at 4.89. I might switch out that power supply. I don't know what this is all about. Available option 000. Now I gotta wait again. Hey, you literally get 3 presses and then it's like, nope. Come on. What the hell? Thing acts funky like that. Can I page up, page down, modify? Apparently I can't modify this. But according to that, it's got thermal fan control. Onboard game port. Onboard MIDI. Wow. That's a decent board. Save and exit. Up one. Oh, come on. Jesus. Never had a BIOS that did that before. It makes you wait. Whatever. It's got to be because of the RAM stick I have in there. So, yeah. System works. I'm probably going to throw my best AGP card I have in there, max out the memory, and make this my retro gamer because I love the case. Let's go ahead and power it off. If I didn't just break it. There we go. But, alright guys. That's the video. Hope you enjoyed it. It's really long-winded. Really long. More than probably about 20, 30 minutes. So yeah. Those are the finds and they all seem to work. I'll do a video on the other system, the Gateway. No, not a Gateway. It's a Hewlett-Packard. It's a newer one. Pentium 4. Probably early days Pentium 4, like 1.8 gigahertz or lower. I think they only went down to a 1.8, but I'm not sure. But it's got totally blown out VRM caps. I don't even think it's going to boot. But it does have a hard drive, so never know. But talk to you guys later.